Hello, everyone. This is once again. This is Aaron Forster with Beers and Buddies, and I'm coming to you live from my home here in Mesa, Arizona. And it's time for our Wednesday weekly beer conversation roundup. And I'm just waiting for Scott to join in. Go ahead and add him right now.
Just waiting for Instagram. Oh, there! Instagram finally caught up. There he is.
Here I am. Hey.
So, just a kind of a recap. Yeah, this is our weekly Wednesday wonky talk. I don't know. I was trying to do like one of those like every single word starts with a W.
So weekly Wednesday wacky wanderings. I don't know. It's a thing that keeps us sane in quarantine, although you're in less quarantine now than I am.
Yep. So Arizona, as of this last weekend, has opened up. So about 90% of the state is open. There are certain things like sporting events are going to start up here soon, but with no audience, no crowds. And then also restaurants are open at maximum 50 capacity, 50%. I mean, same with breweries. So this last Saturday, I actually went to Oso Brewing in Gilbert, Arizona. It was really interesting because, once again, it was half full. They had I was at the bar top. And they had about 6 feet sections in between groups of chairs. But also, rather than having regular menus, it was a QR, all digital. So you just use your phone to, instead of having something in your hand. Really great experience, really good beer. Oh, am I glitching?
Yeah. Jacob Pritchett, I think that's how you pronounce that. You joined us. Thank you so much. Hopefully that glitching stops. That'd be great.
It might be on your end
Yeah, it could be. I don't know. I've had some, who knows, right? But today we're going to do something that's a little bit more up my wheelhouse, and that's, we're going to talk a little bit about the history of the craft beer revolution. And in fact, one of the interesting things at the very start of all this quarantine thing, at least here in California, which has been going on a little longer, one of the questions I had brought to bear was what degree will the quarantines and the COVID-19 actually impact the craft beer revolution? And there was already some trends demonstrating that in certain periods or certain parts of the country that breweries were closing faster than they were opening. And so COVID may just expedite a process that was already underway. Strong Beers, thanks for joining us here today. Again, we're talking about the craft beer revolution and the history of that. But I thought it would be important to talk a bit about where that revolution started and how it began and some of the trends. And since Aaron himself has become an intrepid home brewer, the reality is that there was home brewing became a very significant part of the craft beer revolution. So when I get to that part, Aaron's going to chime in a little bit. Yep. Revolution. Yes, revolution. So,
always,
before we get to that, let's talk about our beers that we have selected for the day. So I know you're
going to hate mine.
is it a cider or a seltzer?
No.
What is it?
Okay. So I went to Total Wine, the other day, and in addition to getting some single malt scotch, which, by the way, when you come out and visit, Scott, we got some of that really good Abelor. And then I got some Stone Delicious IPA from my wife, who has celiac, so she can actually drink it. A lot of people don't know Stone Delicious IPA is technically gluten-reduced. But while I was there, I was looking in the seasonal stuff, and I found a Southern Tier IPA. This is a pint of Vanilla Whip. Your grimace in your face says it all. This is Scott's favorite style that's currently popular right now, and it's a milkshake IPA. So this one comes from Southern Tier, which we love their stouts. They do amazing stouts. But this one is a traditional IPA. You have brewed with two-row flaked oats, Citra, Mosaic, Amarillo, and Zaca with lactose milk sugar, and then vanilla beans on the cold side. But, yep, so this one is definitely going to be it's part of their shake shop series. Yeah, so currently sipping.
That's a hell of a That's a hell of a beer he's drinking.
Blueberry glazed donut milkshake IPA.
Blueberry glazed donut milkshake IPA. I've never heard of River Styx. That sounds like a beer I think Aaron would like. It would be a beer I would try.
The last milkshake IPA I've had, it's been a long time, because I usually don't drink them. Because I do find a lot, it's still slightly odd. But it was from Toolbox in San Diego.
Oh, yeah, they went out of business. They went out of business.
But they had a peach milkshake IPA that I thought was great.
Okay. Did you get that in the state, or did you find that? Are you from that state? I guess I shouldn't assume, because I don't know.
Oh, for a strong beers comment from Massachusetts Brewery?
Yeah.
All right, so I'm going to go ahead and pour this so you can see what it looks like.
Looks hazy. Well, I think people are going to like mine a little bit better just because it's more relevant. And when I say relevant, I mean
IPAs
like...
They're pretty popular, sir.
No, I don't mean the style of beer.
Oh.
Pet the Tiger.
Pet the Tiger. Oh, gosh.
Yes. Yes, Woo! Pet the Tiger. This is from Green Cheek, yeah, Green Cheek, California IPA. I'm not really sure what that means, California IPA, maybe. Probably a hot bomb. I've never had it.
Well, technically, since they're not in San Diego, they can't call them, maybe they're trying to do, like, their own, just West Coast.
I don't know, but there you go. It's definitely a very different-looking IPA.
Tell me if this smells like a different type of IPA.
Well, there you go. Look at the clarity on that bad boy. You can see through it. That's what I want to see. That's what I want to see.
All right.
I'm assuming strong beers, your beer looks a lot more like Aaron's than it does mine.
Interesting. So I was looking at Wren House. They announced a beer release for this weekend because they do a Wally series. It's part of their Hazies series. And there's like Good Boy Wally, Bad Boy Wally, Stay Home Wally. Now they have another one's coming out called Poolside Wally. And because Wally is the name of the dog when they're dogs, that's really cute. But anyways, this is a triple hazy IPA, and it looks like solid. It looks solid.
But, like you could stick your spoon in it, and it just
yes, it looks so thick just in the photos. But I mean, the Wally series is very popular. But anyways, I'm gonna go ahead and try this. It smells vanilla is definitely in there. It smells almost like slightly sweet, hoppy, a little bit of vanilla, which is kind of a weird kind of a combination.
Well, you know, we'll see.
That's weird.
Yeah, see? Juicehead Boy, thanks for joining us here today. We're just doing our quick overview of the beers we're drinking, and then we're going to get into some history of craft beer. I saw it on your face. I saw it. Your face didn't immediately go, oh!
Okay, I'm not gonna say. Okay, I will. Will I say it's bad? No, there's nothing wrong with this beer. There is nothing. There's the flavor combination is kind of like almost like a orange and cream with a slight hop presence to it, which is kind of weird. Once again, that's been a long time since I've had a milkshake IPA. It's probably gonna be another long time before I have another one.
Well,
I'm willing to try. I'm willing to be.
There you go. This is the Pet the Tiger beer is a pretty standard IPA. It's not got a lot of malt forwardness. It's very clean finishing, very light and bright. A lot of citrus notes. I'm getting some lemon on here, but also some very traditional sort of hints of pine as well. One of the things I'll say about Green Cheek is that they're really known for their hazies and their milkshakes, but these people know how to make any really type of beer. I mean, they nail it. And so I have no problem drinking their hazies and their milkshakes, but they had this Pet the Tiger, and with the Netflix Tiger, I might feed this to a tiger when I'm done. I don't know. Maybe they'll make a show after me. But nonetheless, it's a solid beer and it's hot. So that's what I got. It's good. Yep. So
this kind of a recap. So I had Southern Tier out of New York, their vanilla whip, a vanilla forward milkshake IPA. Yeah, the lingering taste is vanilla. I mean, once the hops kind of die down, my mouth tastes like a vanilla milkshake. It does.
Yeah, that's fun. So there you go. Yeah, and I got the
tiger. Hey, but I was willing to give it a shot. Why not?
Yeah, if you haven't watched our previous episode where we talked about Aaron and my differences in beers, and I actually drank, there's my grammar. I consumed a peach milkshake or something to that degree from Ritual Brewing, and it was good, but I just don't like it. So, okay, so what's up with the craft beer revolution? There's a lot. That's my son in the back. See ya. Yeah.
But let's go jump in the Wayback Machine and go back in time.
Let's go way back. So when did this all start? So for those of you who like craft beer, one of the things that I know Aaron and I really both appreciate about drinking beer is not just the product itself, but the culture behind it, and the folks who make it. And for me, as being a historian, I really appreciate the history behind it. And you know, when we talk about craft beer and its history, I mean, beer goes back to almost to the dawn of man. There's some people who will argue that, you know, beer saved the world, that agriculture itself and irrigation itself was created.
Fun fact, I actually learned yesterday at Total Wine. Apparently, one form of commodity in ancient Egypt was beer.
Well, that's not surprising. That
blew me. It doesn't surprise me, but it kind of does surprise me at the same time. Like, oh, hey, let me pay you in beer. Which is kind of like what we
absolutely
do. Hey, man, will you help me fix my car? Sure, I'll pay you in pizza and beer.
That's been going on since the dawn of time, right? Everyone wants beer. But I don't want to get too deep in the weeds about, you know, when beer was first created in the ancient world. I mean, obviously in the United States, and you're still feeling this today, the impact of Prohibition with the 18th Amendment, that really revolutionized the way in which beer drinking occurred in the country. Mm-hmm. It also changed the way in which beer was distributed. If you follow the way beer is distributed, you'll know that there is in this country a 3-tiered system. And in fact, in some states, there's a 4-tier system where packaging is more fully regulated.
Oh, didn't know that.
But the 3-tier system is basically you break apart the producer of beer, a brewer, the distributor of a beer, someone like Constellation, and the seller or the retailer of beer. And a lot of that had to do with wanting to regulate how beer was being brought to bear for the consumer in the post-prohibition world.
I thought part of it was for quality control as well.
It might have been, but most of it had to do with taxation. The state, the country needed to be able to tax the revenue. And of course, if you are able as a producer of beer or any alcoholic beverage to sell directly to the consumer, then the state loses out on those tax revenues.
Yeah, I think they probably sold, because to my understanding back in the day, it's like, because obviously all those, the moonshiners and all the bootleggers, they would cut it with whatever, and so you'd have inconsistent alcohol, and so you get poor quality alcohol, in some cases like poisonous, and then you'd have stuff that was really, really, so the inconsistency were, so I was one of the selling features of adding the 3-tier system was that the middleman, the distributor, was there to ensure quality of the product to get to the consumer, to make sure that they weren't getting something tainted. That was something that was sold to the public as part of that law.
You know, and it's interesting if that was true, and I don't know if it is, it might be, but it's interesting because a lot of beers on the shelves today that you buy at your Total Wine or your Ralph's or wherever you shop at, it's the distributor who is supposed to regulate the product and make sure that they take old stuff off the shelves. I can't tell you how many times I've bought beer from retail venues that are just bad. So if quality control is supposed to be something that distributors are supposed to be working with or working
toward.
With
quality control coming out of the, like they're basically going to check it as it's coming in and then get to the retailer, and then it's up to the retailer to sell it from that point.
Yeah, but if they don't, the distributor comes in and restocks, they should take old stuff off the shelf.
Should,
but they don't. But that impact of prohibition, and not to mention, I mean, prohibition absolutely wiped out breweries in this state. I have some stuff here, and I don't remember exactly where it's at here.
Well,
but
fun
as
story. As Scott's looking that up, as you're looking that up, there's a brewery in San Diego, which has its origins from New York. It's Epic. We actually talked about them last week.
Yes, we did.
And I think they were affected by prohibition as well back in the day. Mm-hmm. So they were basically a German, like a Bavarian style brewery in New York. I want to say was it Brooklyn or the Bronx or something like, but they we talked to their owners in San Diego years ago and how they were bringing back their family brand that basically died decades and many decades ago.
Yeah. So I don't know the exact number of breweries that existed in the United States on the wake of Prohibition, but it was in the thousands.
Really?
I think, oh yeah.
Well, that's a lot for that
Easily
time.
2 or 3,000 breweries. In January of 1985, there was 100 breweries open and operating in the United States. 100,
Wow.
right?
I didn't know that.
That skyrockets over the next 20 years. I mean, you hit 5,000 breweries within 20 years. And of course, we could talk about market saturation and demand and what have you. But Prohibition did a lot to really change the legal structure of craft breweries. It changed the nature of our drinking patterns as well. Why is Bud Light and Miller Lite and Pabst and Schlitz, not so much now, but before, why were they so popular? And the reality is that following Prohibition, many of the German immigrants who had established breweries that were able to continue working through Prohibition, they came to define the drinking habits of American society. And it's not really until after World War II that Americans begin to come back and they begin to develop a palate for more old world style beers. Now, that doesn't mean in the 50s and 60s that you automatically see a revolution, but you do begin to see a demand for imported beers. And then you begin to see those types of styles being played around with. Now, the craft beer revolution, and if I sound like a teacher and you're watching this, I'm sorry, it's because I am a teacher. There's where you go. Yeah, except I don't
okay.
normally get to drink while I teach, so that's fun.
Yeah, but at the same time, at least you get to drink with me and
Yeah, it's
anybody else
great.
is watching.
But the very first real, I think if you had to pinpoint, well, let me ask you, who would you pinpoint? And you may know the answer to this. And if you
Okay.
do, then I would ask this question. If you know the answer to this question, who would you have thought it would have been before you knew the answer? And if you don't know the answer, who do you think it would be? Who would you pinpoint as being the kind of the founding father of the craft beer revolution in the United States?
Well, as marketing has told me, Sam Adams.
Okay, Sam Adams.
That's just because their marketing machine would pretty much present them as, "Hey, we're not the Miller, we're not the Coors or the Milwaukees or whatever. So we're the underdog, we're the new guy." And that we're shortly after that, then you have like the Stone going after that too, but
So Sam Adams first came on the scene, or the Boston Beer Company first came on the scene in 1984. And in fact, there was actually a huge controversy because Samuel Adams received a bunch of awards from the GABF competition, and they weren't producing their own beer. They were contract brewing, and they kept winning year after year after year. And a lot of home brewers, craft brewers began to get very upset about that because they weren't producing their own beer. Now that's not to say anything against the Boston Beer Company. He's definitely fighting an uphill battle. But the grandfather of the craft beer revolution that we know it today would really be a man by the name of Fritz Maytag, which you're probably familiar with because of the Maytag appliance company, who he
Oh.
was a member of. And you've probably heard of the brewery that he purchased, and he purchased it in, I would say, August 1965. And that is the name Anchor. Anchor Steam, Anchor Brewing Company,
Oh.
is the brewery. It was about to go under, and Fritz Maytag just happened to be in San Francisco, and he was said, he was, I think he was sitting at a bar, as the story goes, and he
They're
was
also,
told,
aren't
"Hey,
they
go
the one
check
that
out this
pioneered
brewery."
the California Steamer
Yeah,
beer?
yeah. Well, the Anchor Brewing Company was already making steam beer, and he sort of kept it on. But one of the things that he does is he brings in a new philosophy about, pure ingredients and non-adulterated beers. And today that sounds great, but at the time that he is trying to sell this beer, it's like you're trying to sell an IPA to somebody, to an entire country, that the only thing that they know is
Our
Budweiser,
loggers.
not Bud Light, because the light beers aren't even in existence yet. Those things don't even exist. You're talking Coors Banquet, Budweiser for sure, Schlitz, Pabst, and so, you're trying to convince people, convince restaurants to purchase your beer
At a premium price.
at a premium price. And people are like, why the hell would I do that? And so, it's an uphill battle. And so Fritz Maytag definitely a pioneer. Now, unfortunately, Anchor Brewing Company is no longer independently owned. It's now owned by Sapporo, so it's one of the sellouts.
Also, we have a comment from Jacob Pritchett, who actually talks about for the distribution.
Oh, your conversation about distributors. There are stories of the founder breaking into restaurants to check out how old the kegs were. Oh, no. I don't know if that's a great thing or a bad thing. Actually, that might be awesome. You know, you want to know how old your stuff is. I mean, I don't want some stale beer, right?
Yeah.
But I think Fritz Maytag has to be kind of given the credit for that. And then shortly thereafter, in 76, you have the earliest existence of what eventually will become the Brewers Association. Cook from Sam Adams. I've heard some stories about that guy. In fact, at one point, I heard a story. I don't know if this is true, but I heard that he was in a bar a few years back, and he yelled at the bartender because they didn't have Sam Adams on tap. They didn't have any of his product on tap. And the reality is that, you know, a few years ago, Sam Adams is not as relevant as a craft beer. You know, I mean, it's making millions of barrels of beer each year. That's a different story. but I do think that Samuel Adams has to be given some credit for sort of introducing more flavorful beer. I mean, it's definitely the beer that got me into craft beer.
I had one, I want to say about 3 months ago before quarantine kicked in. And honestly, it's not that bad. I had a Boston Lager. I was like, you know what? I haven't had one in a long time. I'm going to give it a shot. And it was still a solid beer for what it was.
Yeah, I mean, it's not a bad beer. It's just not, you know, I'm not going to go and order one. And you know, unless it's literally the only thing on tap besides Bud Light, which I'm not going to buy.
Funny story. So I actually was entertaining a German. I'm sorry, he was a Danish businessman. He was coming over for a business trip. We were talking a business and things like that. We had a dinner meeting basically, and we went to a tap house for dinner. And it was up in North Scottsdale. We had just gone to the world famous Barrett Jackson car auction because he wanted to see American Muscle and all this kind of stuff. And we went to But so we went to this tap house, and he had this laundry list of all these beers. And of all the beers he wanted to try was actually a Boston Lager of all the beers. not a California West Coast IPA, he wanted an American Sam Adams Boston Lager because he says, honestly, that's what we hear about over here in Europe.
In the Netherlands, yeah. Well, you know, I mean, it really made a name for itself. And he didn't work alone, Jim Cockton. He had I can't remember her name, but there was a lady who really worked with him. His story is an interesting one, allegedly. I'm assuming it's true, but allegedly he finds this recipe from his grandfather or great-great-grandfather, what have you. And he begins to brew it. Works out for him. But I think this is where I think it sort of affects the craft beer industry is that in 1978, Jimmy Carter signs a law, H.R. 1337, which is a bill that had an amendment in it that allowed for homebrewers to be able to make beer legally for the first time since Prohibition in their homes. Now, not every state allowed that. In fact, I think Mississippi was one of the very last ones to do so many, many years later.
Of all states, Mississippi. That's kind of
yeah.
Weird.
I think that was. I'll check that fact. Here in a second. But one of the things you're going to find is that in the 80s and 90s, those who opened up breweries, many of which no longer exist. You know, you think of New Albion, for example, that was one of the very first craft brew pubs. In fact, brew pubs were far more common than breweries. In some respect, because of the distribution system, brew pubs didn't have to go through a distributor. They could produce and sell because they were a retail option as well. It wasn't until years later that microbreweries began to overtake brew pubs.
You say that. So my first real experience or exposure outside of Sam Adams to craft beer and people homebrewing was actually on the Drew Carey Show. So in later seasons, so
it wasn't Barack Obama's white honey beer that they made?
No. So in the Drew Carey Show, later in the seasons, he actually has a little shack. He's got a little brew shack. And he ends up doing what's called Buzz Beer. And what it was is he did a coffee beer, a coffee flavored beer. And then he ended up making like his brew shack was big enough. It was like a 50 gallon setup. And he ended up selling it to his local taverns, basically selling it in bottles and stuff like that. So they could get some extra money on the side. Kind of a little fun side, kind of a little jump side note was as they're trying to determine what beer should they make that's popular. They do a beer tasting and they all have different types of, hey, well, let's try this. Let's try that. And one of the beers that Oswald, who's one of the kind of the more quirky characters, did was a Tabasco flavored beer. And he's like, we're going to call it Tabirsco.
That's gross.
And he's like, so they start drinking. They're like, ah, oh, it's burning their mouth. They say, like, want some water? Yes. $5 a bottle. That's how we really make our money.
That's how you make it. Because no one wants to drink that beer.
But anyway, so just that's saying going into that was in pop culture. I want to say that was a little late 90s with the Drew Carey show. We're talking about he was home brewing and selling to his local tavern kegs to and bottles so he could make money on the side.
Well, and that's what you do. But those home brewers were the ones that really pioneered the craft beer revolution. I mean, definitely Fritz Maytag had its role. Sam Adams, you know, definitely played a role, but it's really these small home brewers, many of whom their breweries aren't open anymore. But I bring that up because, you know, you've begun to home brew. And mm-hmm. I think what happened is you saw a lot of people who were so over drinking piss water. Sorry, that's what I call it. And they thought, you know, it's cheaper and I can make these imported style beers for myself at a much cheaper cost. Obviously, maybe a little bit more than now, because obviously finding homebrew materials is going to be a little bit easier now. Mm-hmm. But these folks were experimenting. They were the pioneers. They were the ones laying the groundwork for what would eventually become. And I don't need to say it's an easy trek. I've seen a lot of people open up breweries. It's not easy. There's a lot of red tape you have to fight through. But what you don't have to fight through is trying to convince the public to drink your beer. You open a brewery in 2020, assuming the state will allow you to do so. I don't have to convince you to drink an IPA or, you know, well, that seems to be the only beer people care about anymore is IPA. Introduced, by the way, in January 1989. Did you know that? That was kind of the first major introduction to the GABF category.
Okay, for GABF, yeah, but say that's been GABF. Going back.
Not as a style. That's been
that's been going back since the British Imperial dynasty going to India and overhopping it for sanitary
preservation. But for GABF, for intents and purposes, IPAs are the style of beer for American craft beer drinkers, right? Whether it's
– It was in the 80s. You know, wow.
Yeah, right? So, but with that in mind, and then I can get a little bit – you know, we can talk a little bit about Sierra Nevada, and you can talk about Stone in the 90s, really introducing some, like, bold beers, Arrogant Bastard.
That still is a polarizing beer.
It is. It's a great beer. I think it's fantastic. It's malty, it's hoppy, and it's aggressive. And you don't see a lot of people making beers like it anymore because no one wants to drink that. They want to drink IPAs or what they call IPAs, like what you just consumed. So I just briefly want to spend a few minutes here because the home brewers became such an integral part and you yourself have become a home brewer. I mean, how would you see yourself back in the 80s homebrewing? I mean, would you, obviously, I doubt you'd be making some of the beers that maybe run through your head, even if you don't make them. I know some of the beers you have made, probably folks may not have made. I know you made a lime beer at one point.
Key Lime Pie Blonde.
Yeah, so that probably would not have been something. And again, I don't know for sure because I've not been in every single homebrewer's recipe book, right? That may have been there. But, you know, where do you see yourself in that?
That's a good question. I mean, if I were to flashback myself, current situation, but back in the 80s, homebrewing, if anything, I've probably been doing more malt-forward beers, like darker beers, because just if you look back in history, like at that time, everyone's drinking like Budweiser or Bud Light in some cases, Miller, Milwaukee's. So a lot more like the lagered beers, just Pilsner's lagers. Chances are, knowing my palate would be the same, I've probably been doing more stouts,
By the
porters.
way, Bud Light founded in 1982. I think Bud Light came out after Miller Light. Let me look that up.
But yeah, I think I probably would have done more European, like brown ales, browns. I'm not a big fan of reds unless they're really, really
Oh, wow.
caramely forward.
It's a little older than I thought.
But
Sorry.
that's fine. So I think that's where, as a home brewer, you can also keep in mind that they didn't have a lot of the specialty malts that we have now. So it would have been a very unique way of home brewing. But still, I think it probably maltier, like European beers, if anything.
Yeah, and I think that would have appealed to people who were like yourself, right? Who were willing to pay extra to go get the imported beers that they became accustomed to. But the mass market, and I even think even today, as big as craft beer is, there's still a lot of people out there who, Heineken's their wheelhouse. Not to be,
Oh.
I'm not being punny, but Corona is where they go.
There is a time and a place when Corona is acceptable, and I have
I don't
proven
know.
that
Yeah.
multiple times.
Yeah, no, I disagree. Corona is literally
Hey,
the worst
I
beer on
was in the Bahamas, in the same cove that Robert Louis Stevenson, who wrote the Treasure Island books, got inspiration from this island I was on. My butt in a freaking chair on the beach, like crystal clear waters, Corona with a lime. I'm like, it was like, okay, thank you, marketing of Corona. You have ingrained that in my mind.
And that's what they're selling you is a moment, not good beer,
And it was a
right?
good moment.
Yeah, I get it. But following that, you see, we could get into, and I don't have time for that, all these new breweries that were opening up. And this isn't to say that breweries didn't exist. One of the things that I got a chance to do, and you had mentioned me bring it up, but I got to sit down with the author of a book called Brewing Arizona. And I sat down with him on a podcast called Tap That AZ.
Shout out.
Good shout out to Tap That AZ. Got to talk a little bit about that. One of the things I learned was that Arizona had had a number of breweries long before the craft brewing industry. And one of the things that was surprising to me was that the buyouts that we see and have seen happening were not new to 2000s. That had been going on long before. But I think there is a cultural difference. I think that one of the reasons why you saw people like Goose Island sell out and Ballast Point, at least at the time that it did sell out, or Golden Road, or Four Peaks, or whomever they are, is one, there's a lot of money that was being thrown their way. I mean, again, Ballast Point, and I'm just gonna go out and say it, that was the most absurd buyout I've ever seen in my life. A little over $1 billion, I think, by the time the thing was said and done. They needed to hire a new accountant, whoever was looking at that, because that just didn't make any freaking sense. But
Right.
I think Goose Island, they sold out for like 38 million, 39 million, something like that. But I think part of the thing that's going on now is, these breweries, they want to appear crafty. And in fact, I was reading something earlier today, and I think it's the Brewers Association. Don't quote me on that because I don't want to misspeak. But someone came out with the term craft versus crafty. And
Okay.
basically, let me, oh, right here. December 2012, craft versus crafty. I'm just going to read this. As big brewers buy formerly independent breweries, the Brewers Association, so that was good, the Brewers Association releases a statement discussing craft versus crafty. In it, BA writes, quote, "Multinational brewers, InBev, MillerCoors, appear to be deliberately attempting to blur the lines between their crafty, craft light beers and true craft beers from today's small and independent brewers." Right? So
Okay.
I think probably one of the most, or two of the most well-known crafty beers would be Blue Moon and Shock Top, right? both of which I think are not good. Shock Top being InBev, Blue Moon being Miller Coors, which you hear me right. For those of you who watch this that don't know, Miller Coors, one company, they combined forces because they had to in order to fight off AB InBev, which
Miller
was...
Miller Coors and also Molson.
Yeah, and Anheuser-Busch went with a distribution InBev, but that's a whole other thing.
Stella, yeah. Artois.
So, you know, I think that type of movement was going on before the 2000s, but I think the culture, the reason for buying them was different. I from what I could read from Sipos's book about Arizona craft breweries, was that they were being bought out for economic reasons. It wasn't necessarily to try and buy out a brewery because of the type of beer they were making or to appear a certain way. It just made financial sense.
So kind of like Microsoft, can't beat them.
You might as well buy them, right? And of course that then lends itself, and I'm jumping ahead a little bit here because I mean to really talk about the craft beer history, I mean you really have to get into there's this brewery and this brewer. I mean you talk about Ken Grossman at Sierra Nevada. You know, you talk about why can't I think of his name? Jim over at Stone.
I can't remember his name.
Yeah, I keep thinking Jim Parsons, but that's a big thing.
No.
Right? You think about New Belgium Brewing Company, which of course just sold Sam over at Dogfish Head, which just combined forces with the Boston Beer Company in 2019.
Yeah, which is nuts.
Yeah, right. So I mean, we could talk about all these things, but I think as craft beer became more plentiful. And it became more popular, and it became kind of an in vogue thing to do. I know that throughout the 90s, you could see the trend went up, and then early 2000s, it took a dip. And there's various reasons for that dip. I'm not going to get into those right now. But then it began to rise, and then it almost became – it just blew up. And I know by the time that Aaron and I both began Beers and Buddies, and we both began to sort of talk about market oversaturation, and you know, I mean, does there come a point when you can't meet the styles anymore? I mean, is there only so many styles, and then you're just kind of having these variations? I mean, we're talking about the beer that Aaron drank tonight. Is that really beer? I mean, and that type of discourse is important because when we start defining what beer is and what beer isn't, the Brewers Association needs to get in on that. How much beer can be produced? The Brewers Association gets in on that. And then one of the things, and I'm jumping pretty ahead here to 2017, so I'm getting kind of current. Okay. And Aaron and I both wrote a article on this for an online publication. Was
Arizona
about
Food and Beer.
Yeah. The independent craft logo that you find. And I don't know, Green Sheet does not have it. On their can, but the whole point of that is to differentiate. Yeah, it's to differentiate independent craft brewers from non-independent craft brewers. I mean, there was this absurd. You remember the absurd moment to try and buy AB InBev?
Yes, it was a GoFundMe account.
I mean, it wasn't going to work. So. I don't know. And, you know, I think that craft beer, it's been resilient. I mean, we're talking about a revolution that began in the 60s. It gained steam, anchor steam, what? In the 80s and 90s, and then it exploded in the 2000s, and it began to taper off. The question is, where does it go from here?
Well, I just sent Scott an article the other day. Actually, was it yesterday?
Today.
I think.
Today.
About a very prominent brewery shutting down their tap room, like for good.
Yeah. Yeah. And that brew is Three Floyds.
Oh, Three Floyds. Yeah.
Three Floyds. And that brewery, it's like, come on.
They have national distribution, very popular, very steady following of drinkers. And because of virus stuff,
yeah.
Bye-bye.
You know, they've got one of the most popular barrel-aged stouts on the planet, which is Dark Lord.
Yeah.
You know, and I've had some Three Floyd stuff, and it's good stuff. And so in the end, I think one of the things that's going to be interesting if you have scholars who actually get into this to look at what was in fact the cause of a decline in the craft beer revolution. Are we now seeing a moment where craft beer is not going to be as important? Are we going to see less breweries? Are we going to see a retraction in styles? Are we going to see a retraction in innovation?
You know, I'm seeing a lot more rise in Arizona. I mean, don't get me wrong. There's been some new breweries that have opened up in the past year, but I've been seeing, not just in Arizona, a higher rise of tap houses. Because when you go to like Total Wine or something like that, you look in the shelf and you see all these beers, and you know what you end up usually doing? Grabbing what you normally want, maybe a one or two cheaper ones to try later, and you leave. Whereas in Arizona, we have a company. I basically started with Wandering Tortoise. They're in Central Phoenix. They're a tap house, and they get amazing stuff. They get from places that distributors can't get because they mule it from all over the place. And likewise, they have other tap houses that they've expanded, and people like going to them because they can get a flight of all these different beers from all over the country, stuff that's not even bottled, and try it. Like King's Convenience in Central Phoenix.
That's what I was thinking of.
Yeah, a brilliant tap house. I mean, they put any of their beers on tap can go into a crowler. So you're talking barrel-aged stouts that are normally like $20 a bottle. You can get 32 ounces for like, what, $15? I mean,
yeah, we don't have anything out here that's quite like that. I mean, we have tap rooms. My favorite is the Brickyard, but they don't sell beer to go. But they keep most of their lineup is pretty local, California-esque. I mean, they've got a few things there too that aren't, but it's not like King's.
King's has like quality craft beer. We're talking true craft. Like, you will not get bottles, cans, nothing. But they'll magically have a keg, like a slim keg from some little brewery in the Midwest or whatever on tap, and you get to try it. So it's really impressive. And those are becoming very, very, very popular in Arizona because it's that exclusivity. They get to try something different. They don't get to spend a ton of money. They can have just a taster. Or if they want to take a crowler, they can. I'm seeing a lot of those popping up in Arizona. But also, there are still a few other breweries that are going to be opening up soon, like Greenwood, which is a female-owned and female-brewed brewery that's opening up in downtown Phoenix.
Which, by the way, I saw this. And Pink Boots, want to guess what year that Pink Boots first meeting of Pink Boots?
90s?
Oh, later than that, much later than that.
Really?
Yeah, 2008.
Wow.
Yeah.
So for those who don't know, Pink Boots Society is basically a group of female brewers and those in the brewing industry, the craft beer scene, help promote education and actually careers in the brewing industry which is a male-dominated industry. And so this is basically a group of women supporting other women to try to get into this through, because it is science at the same time. It's fun. It's science. It's cooking. It's baking. It's everything, all in one. And at the same time, it's a involved process. It's a lot of fun. And it's sad that there aren't as many women. Because actually, like I said, with Greenwood opening up, also one of my good friends, his wife, she in the past year she started brewing on a production scale. And she loves it. And this would be, Greg, Greg's wife Jenna, and so she's made a couple recipes, brewed the beers, and they turned out phenomenal. So I mean, once again, this is a trend in Arizona. We're seeing a few more female owned. Granted, it's still not the same ratio of men to women, but it's still happening.
Well, but the ratio of I don't know the numbers, but women drink beer I think as much as men do. And that would be an interesting conversation. I'd have to do a lot more research, but the disparity, the demographic disparities, we have a movement down here in Los Angeles. Black people like beer too. And the whole idea is that
people of different skin color actually like beer.
Yeah. But the idea was that, and I don't know, it's not just an idea, but the reality is that there seemed to be a lot of white men dominating the beer scene. And that the you know, it's not just a white male oriented industry. And so that brings a very unique sort of discussion into the larger discourse of craft beer is, you know, when you look at some of the history of the early founding fathers of beer, they're white men, right? They pioneered that. And that's not to discredit or to say anything negative about their accomplishments, because it's not. But the truth is that you didn't see a lot of non-white people sort of pioneering that movement. And I suspect there's a lot of structural reasons for that.
But we won't go into that today.
I'll go way off on that. You know, why don't we see more, you know, Asian, Chinese, Japanese owned breweries, or more Indian breweries, or any, you know, I mean,
that's a good question.
Pick somebody, right? But I know with the Pink Boots, I've always supported them. You know, always in the sense, like, once I found out they were a thing, I supported them. Because I am a self-identified feminist, and I think that it's very important for women to interject themselves. I mean, the very first brewer that I knew that was a woman came out of Idaho, and her beer was amazing. Arrow Lodge Brewing Company here near Covina in Southern California, female brewer, amazing beers. And it just seems ridiculous and absurd and problematic for anyone to imagine that men can make beer better. And to me, it's not an issue of, well, women historically cook. That's not the point. That's not even what I'm trying to say. It's, you know, why couldn't women do the same thing? Why can't African Americans or anybody,
that's fine. But going back to the original questions, so we talked about the history of like craft beer, where it kind of started, the laws changing, where it was in the 90s, early 2000s, and here we are now, where we haven't had a world event like this in nearly a century, where it affected the world in such an economic global scale, really since the early 1900s. Wars aside, I should say.
The Spanish flu. 1918.
So we haven't had anything like this in basically a century. So here we are now with like ultimate, I'm not going to lie, my goal, my retirement goal, I would love to open up a craft brewery in Arizona and basically spend my retirement making beer and basically talking about beer with other people and having fun. But is that even going to be possible in the next 10, 15 years? It's going to be hard to say. Is demand going to be there anymore? If I had a crystal ball, I'd be making a lot more money.
Well, yeah. Wouldn't that be everyone's crystal ball? Well, I could get into a lot more, but I think that's a good sort of wrapping up point. If you're interested in the history of beer, you can follow me at A Crafty Historian. Or you can follow us at Beers and Buddies. I'm part of both. We can talk more about that, but there's also a lot of great, great literature out there. If you're interested in reading, I'll show you real quick before we end this, but I'll show you the book that I think is fantastic as a survey. And what I mean by that is just a broad overview. I'm nerding out.
Oh gosh. So as Scott goes and gets that, kind of just to jump and interject. So my homebrew that I'm working on right now is a hazy IPA with Bravo, Cascade, Galaxy hops, and El Dorado hop oil. So kind of picked that up from Sierra Nevada. So I'm really excited to be trying that. But I'm actually currently working on a recipe with my buddy Adam on a Hefeweizen. I'm going to try to do a Bavarian Hefeweizen. The idea is I love a good banana, bubblegummy, clovey, F, and it's almost time for summer, but all the beers I make actually are gluten reduced, so that's for my wife. So fingers crossed on all that, those recipe makings. Gosh, Scott sure is taking a while. Admittedly so, Scott has a lot of books. I mean, if you ever see his library, it's a lot of books.
Okay, so there's the book. It's called The Craft Beer Revolution. It's actually written, it's written by Steve Hindy. Steve Hindy was a co-founder of the Brooklyn Brewing Company way back in the day. If you haven't had anything from Brooklyn Brewing Company, you should. It's good.
Eric from Tap That just joined in. Hey, Eric, thanks for joining us. We're just wrapping up our beer history.
We gave you a shout out, though. We talked briefly. We were talking about beer history today, so we talked about our podcast that we did, or your podcast that you invited me to, I guess
Yep,
I
and
should
if you could
say.
tell us what the episode was really quick, because we're hitting towards the end of
If
our
you go
session today.
to a Crafty Historian Instagram, I have it linked in there.
Okay,
So
the
yeah,
link to
you
the
just
Tap
click.
That Agency podcast, where Scott sits down with the author of, oh gosh, what's the, yeah, it was Ed Sipos episode. What was the name of the book again?
Come together. Hold
Maybe Eric can tell us. But great episode where, oh, there it is. Yeah, brewing in Arizona,
right there.
and also Eric from Tap That AZ has also recently brought out a book as well about his journeys over the past year, couple years of brewing in Arizona as well.
So, you gotta check all that stuff out, guys and gals, and everybody, anybody.
Oh, brewing Arizona, that's what it's called. Yeah, brewing Arizona is yep. Yeah, check it out.
Check it out, guys. That's all I got. I mean, I got way more, but that's all I got.
No, I know. So, but I was, so anyways, if you guys have any questions about any of the craft beer history, yeah, check it out with Scott. As far as like for next week, now this is going to be interesting. Scott actually may be coming out to Arizona in
Maybe.
like.
So I'm supposed to go on vacation. But the West Coast is weird, and we're still in quarantine. And it may happen. I know my wife still wants it to happen, and I kind of want it to happen just because, it's gonna be cool. But if it doesn't happen, I'm going to Arizona for two reasons. First and foremost, I need a beer, not for my fridge. Second, Aaron.
Oh, but so yeah, so Scott may be coming out here, which means that we might be doing one of these actually side by side as opposed to top and bottom with
Yeah.
this. But
I'm getting the yell at to go eat dinner.
okay, but
Yeah.
so if Scott does come out, we're thinking about maybe going. We haven't been back to Northern Arizona in about 3 years, so it might
I
be
think we'll
time.
have to do some content. We haven't made any YouTube content in a while, but if we get up there, which we probably will, but if we get up there, I think we gotta have to do something to commemorate. But there is a significant chunk of me that wants to see Oregon go away. But if it doesn't, it doesn't. Either way, I'm going to make my way out there at some point this summer because everything I'm teaching is online. So, and that's me just telling Aaron the rest of you don't care about that.
All right, guys. Well, thanks again for tuning in. Hopefully this was informative and a little bit of fun. And until next week, from my beer.
To your buddy.
Cheers,
Salute,
guys.
guys.